Blackstone Audio presents 30 Days a Black Man, The Forgotten Story That Exposed the Jim Crow South by Bill Steigerwald. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Dedication. To my mother, Catherine, who gave me her good journalism genes. Foreword. A white American pretending to be black is sure to make news. It was front page news and all over television when Rachel Dolezal, an NAACP official from Spokane, Washington, who claimed to be black, was outed as a white woman. And the same kind of sensational coverage was given to a Black Lives Matter activist, Sean King, supposedly a biracial man, when reporters wrote that he was really a white man. The subjects of those 2015 stories opened the door to mockery and contempt from both black and white Americans, and the gates to confusion were flung wide open. Did Dolezal and King see some advantage to being black in America? Given the history of slavery, segregation, and the continuing reality of black people facing everything from higher levels of poverty to higher levels of jail time when compared to whites, why would anyone pretend to be black? During the 1948 journalistic mission of Ray Sprigle and John Wesley Dobbs, to be black meant living in a rigidly segregated America, still dealing with the threat of white people lynching uppity blacks. Being black or pretending to be black was a high-risk game, especially in the Jim Crow South. Any player better have a good reason. Ray Sprigle had a good reason. The nationally renowned journalist wanted to expose to the white readers of the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette what it was like to be a black man in the South. So he shaved his head, sunburned a heavy tan on his skin, and with black civil rights leader John Wesley Dobbs of Atlanta as his guide, took a car ride across the race line in mid-20th century America. Bill Steigerwald's book, 30 Days a Black Man, The Forgotten Story That Exposed the Jim Crow South, narrates Sprigle's epic month-long journey through black life in the land of Dixie. Steigerwald, like Sprigle, worked as a journalist for the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette and has a unique perspective on his fellow newspaper man. But Sprigle was more than a star reporter. Steigerwald presents him as a passionate professional journalist and an intelligent, principled man. This is a man who earned a Pulitzer Prize for exposing Supreme Court Justice Hugo Black's membership in the Ku Klux Klan in 1937. He had also won acclaim for reporting on the horrors taking place behind locked doors at Pennsylvania's state mental hospitals, while going undercover as a patient and later as a hospital attendant. He was a truth-teller committed to unveiling hidden stories of all kinds, even when the truth required him to shave his head, change his name, and darken his skin. Over 30 days, Sprigle learned of the daily humiliations experienced by blacks in the 1948 Deep South. He learned what it felt like to have to ride behind the white folks in the segregated all-black Jim Crow car on the train. He was told that black women couldn't try on clothes at downtown department stores because no white person wanted to buy any dress worn by a black. He was shocked to find out that a sales girl will carefully pin a cloth over her black customer's head before she'll let her try on a hat. He heard of a telephone operator who yelled at a black woman who didn't refer to her as ma'am. And then there were the unequal schools and the constant threat of violence. As a white man, Sprigle knew about the Jim Crow South's segregated schools, but he was confronted by another level of inequality when he came face to face with a leaking old wreck of a shanty that passed for a school for black children. Interviewing black dentists, prosperous farmers, and indigent sharecroppers, he heard the bitter tale of a black church deacon killed by police officers while being held in prison on trumped-up charges. He learned about a black World War II veteran killed for casting a vote in Georgia, and how the dead man's family was forced to move out of the county. The reader can sense Sprigle's pain in telling the tale. Sprigle's newspaper exposé, headlined "I Was a Negro in the South for 30 Days," was a 21-part series in the Post-Gazette that was syndicated to papers nationwide. Bill Steigerwald recounts his daring undercover mission as a testament to the world-changing power of journalism. The series, and the impact it had on millions of ordinary white readers, the Northern and Southern press, and civil rights advocates like Eleanor Roosevelt, helped open mid-century white America to the possibility of a Supreme Court decision ending segregation in public schools, to Dr. Martin Luther King's eloquent call for racial equality, to the urgency of civil rights marches, the sit-in movement, freedom rides, and Congress passing a Voting Rights Act. Yet Sprigle was not the first American writer to use a disguise to expose the horrors of racism. In 1859, a well-known humorist named Mortimer Thompson, then working for the New York Tribune, pretended to be a slave buyer to observe a large slave auction in Savannah, Georgia. Thompson wrote in painful prose about families divided at slave auctions and how the separation is more hopeless than that made by the angel of death, for in the latter case, the loved ones are committed to the care of a merciful deity, but in the other instance, to the tender mercies of a slave driver. In her book, Undercover Reporting, The Truth About Deception, NYU journalism professor and historian Brooke Kroger calls Thompson's account one of the most significant anti-slavery narratives in the run-up period to the Civil War. It was reprinted by various U.S. papers and republished in summary form in the London Times. One Southern paper condemned Thompson for his misrepresentation and falsehood, trying to impose on the willing credulity and excite the mawkish sentimentality of the abolition fanatics of the North. Sprigle is heir to Thompson's work and acts as a journalistic bridge to John Howard Griffin and his 1961 best-selling book, Black Like Me. Griffin also darkened his skin so he could spend several weeks in the South as a black man. Black Like Me was, according to New York Times book reviewer Dan Wakefield, one of the few books that do more than take us across the familiar arid landscape of generalizations and statistics, but convey the feel, sight, sound, and sweat of what the abstractly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.